Thank you so much, Anya. It's, and welcome everybody to this new age of how we'll be doing a conference. Okay, so I'm very excited to be presenting and being able to share this morning with you, even if from afar. So I'll be presenting Discrimination from Below, Experimental Evidence on Female Leadership in Ethiopia. And this is joint work with Shibiru Ayalu and Shanti Mannion. So globally, women are underrepresented in leadership roles, and this gender gap is the largest in low-income countries. For example, by 2013, only 13% of the board seats of major African companies were held by women. Improving gender equity in leadership roles is a key global priority, but there's increasingly growing evidence that leadership and female expertise is being discounted in low-income countries. In this paper, we posit to explore a potential explanation that gender discrimination makes subordinates less likely to adhere to female leadership. Now, if women do face such discrimination from below, then female leaders may appear to be less qualified than male leaders who are of equal ability ex ante. Right, so when we think about leadership success, a large part of that success depends on how well others adhere to your advice or direction. So then, even if women are equally skilled and have similar leadership styles, to the extent that subordinates respond differently to female leadership, such that they're less likely to follow that advice and direction, then this is going to reduce the performance of female-led teams. Now, such discrimination from subordinates has several consequences. First, if female-led teams perform worse, then given that advancement in one's career is usually a function of performance, this is going to generate gender disparities in promotion decisions. Importantly, even when female and male leaders are otherwise identical, and also even when the promotion decision itself is not a consequence of discrimination or is not discriminatory in nature. Second, if subordinates are discounting valuable advice from female leaders, then this is also going to reduce their own welfare and reduce their own performance. And finally, and perhaps most perversely, it can result in a self-reinforcing belief that women are less qualified to hold leadership positions, right? So if it's the case that subordinates believe women are less effective and so therefore don't follow their leadership, this will make female leadership less effective, which in turn justifies that initial belief that people had. So that's our driving motivation in this paper. Even if women and men are equally skilled and have similar leadership styles, does a differential response to women leaders or managers reduce their performance? We then ask whether information on ability can help mitigate such discrimination. And that's really going to allow us to characterize whether the discrimination is driven by statistical discrimination, in which subjects have different beliefs about the average ability level of women, or is it driven by taste-based discrimination, in which subjects may just generally have a dislike or prejudice for taking direction from women? So the way we're going to do this is we implement a lab in the field experiment in which subjects are paired with a leader who gives advice. Our game asks, if all else is equal, is advice provided by a female leader less likely to be heeded when that same advice is being provided by a male leader? Now, the key strength of our design is that the leader is unseen, and we're able to hold all communication between the leader and the subject constant. And so we can be confident that any differences we observe across these treatment arms is really driven by the perceived gender of that leader. On top of this, we layer an additional treatment arm in which we randomize whether subjects are given information on their leader being of high ability. And that's what's really going to help us identify whether any differential responsiveness we observe is driven by statistical discrimination or taste-based discrimination. We supplement the experiment with an additional test for discrimination by asking a subsample of our subjects to evaluate hypothetical resumes for senior management positions in which the candidate gender has been randomly assigned. So we consider this paper to be a strong complement to a handful of recent natural experiments in low-income countries that echo the concern we raise in this paper by documenting differential responsiveness to female expertise, advice, and businesses. For example, this literature has shown that female agricultural trainers in Malawi or female managerial manager trainees in Bangladeshi garment factories are perceived as less effective, and that female businesses attract fewer customers in Ghana. At the same time, there is a strong push to increase female representation, right? There's increasing calls for female health workers, female teachers, female agricultural extension trainers, and there's a strong foundation for these policies. But if it's the case that people are less likely to heed the advice of women, then what does that mean for outcomes on health or outcomes on learning or economic growth more generally? Now, of course, we want to continue to see the push for female representation, but that makes it all the more critical to really understand why we're seeing these types of gender gaps. You know, is it driven by supply side differences? Is it the case that people really aren't responding to gender, but it's just that women on average look quite different? You know, they might be less educated, they're often quite younger. Or if it is because of discrimination, is it because of this idea of a general dislike or violation of gender norms, right? Is it that gender attitudes are really driving that discrimination? Or is it the case that subjects simply cannot infer the quality of the advice that they're being provided, right? The story of statistical discrimination. And so these important natural experiments have really helped identify these important gaps in how people are responding to female leadership, but they really aren't able to identify why they're responding in the way they are. And it's important to understand why they're responding in the way they are, because that's really gonna drive differences in policy solutions. Right? Should we be trying to increase inputs to equalize women? Instead, should we be trying to relax gender norms or change gender attitudes? Or should we really be trying to focus on providing credible signals of quality or ability? And so we see this paper as really trying to identify what are the mechanisms that help explain some of these gender gaps we're observing in more natural experiments. All right, so for the rest of my time, I'm gonna provide a brief theoretical overview, and then I'll just go straight into the game that we present to our subjects. So what we do is we just apply standard models of discrimination into our setting, thinking about an employee and a manager. And so our model starts with saying an employee is willing to follow the directions of their manager if the expected payoff of doing so, which is a function of their manager's ability, is greater than the dislike they experience for following the manager's direction. So the left-hand side of this equation is really trying to capture that statistical discrimination, right? The payoff that an employee gets based on the ability of their manager from following their direction. And the second argument to the right is capturing that taste-based discrimination, the cost that they face in following that direction. And so this setup suggests that employees would be less likely to follow female direction, either because of taste-based discrimination, that there's simply a higher cost in following the directions of women, or it could be because of statistical discrimination, that they believe that their female manager is of lower ability, and so the payoff of following that leadership is going to be lower. Now, consistent with both types of discriminatory motivation, if employees receive a signal that their manager is of high ability, then this is going to suggest a closing of the gender gap. So under taste-based discrimination, it's simply just more costly to give into that general dislike that you have for taking female direction. And under statistical discrimination, employees will update and take a weighted average of ability that they're inferring both from the gender of their manager and also from this new information or this new signal of ability. However, when we think about taste-based discrimination, we should never see a reversal in the gender gap, right? So it might be that no matter what, even with the signal or without the signal, women will always face a higher bar for adherence from their employees because there's simply a greater cost or a greater dislike in following their direction. And so one of the key takeaway from these models is that a reversal in gender discrimination is going to indicate that subjects are behaving based on their beliefs or it's driven by their beliefs about ability rather than a general dislike for taking female direction. Okay. So let me just go ahead and jump in into the experiment that we implemented in Ethiopia. So we implement this experiment in Adama Science and Technology University in Adama, Ethiopia. It's one of the oldest and largest public universities in Ethiopia. And we selected our sample from administrative employees with a relatively high level of education, so a bachelor's degree or higher. What I think is really nice about our sample is these employees are most likely unfamiliar with research of any kind. You know, they've never been asked to participate in these types of lab experiments. And they're in a setting where there is this natural hierarchy, right? A large institution where many of these administrative employees are going to be all throughout the hierarchical structure of the organization. So what, in general, what we do is we match each of our subjects to a leader whose role is simply to play advice on how the subject should play the game. And then the main game we're going to implement is a signaling game that's 10 rounds. And this is adapted from Cooper and Hagel. So it's an experimental game that's been used before. I'll go into it in detail in a second. But we're just going to have a basic 2x2 design in which we randomize the gender of the leader and whether or not we provide this information of their leader being of high ability. Okay, so the goal of our game, in the interest of time, I'm not going to describe the game in its entirety, but the goal was to try to think about a leadership problem in which there's a clear answer, but it would be difficult for subjects to guess. And so what subjects have to do in this game is they choose a number between 1 through 5. The payoff is going to be a function of what number they choose and also a bit of random chance. And people's instinct in this game is to select the number 3, but the expected payoff is actually higher when they select 4 or 5. And so the idea of this game is we're really just gonna have leaders explaining to subjects that they should be selecting 5 and explaining why 3 is not gonna give them the highest payoff. Okay, so who were these team leaders? So each subject was randomly paired to a team leader. These were administrative employees at another university 100 kilometers away. And the leaders were given detailed training on how to play the game, and they had the opportunity to practice before they play. And a key part of our design is that these leaders could send pre-scripted advice to team leaders. And so that's how we're gonna be able to hold the advice constant, because leaders were just saying, yes, I wanna send that advice, or no, I don't wanna send that advice. We selected 1 male and 1 female leader who had identical ways of playing the game, identical responses, and had chose to send the messages. And so from the perception of the subject, these leaders will look identical, except one is male and one is female. The way the subjects interacted with the leaders was they never actually saw them. Instead, the game was played with an enumerator through a smartphone app, as you're seeing on the right side of the screen. So prior to subjects selecting what they wanted to play, they would observe what the leader played, what the result of the leader, how many points they got, and then they would also get this pre-scripted message. And as I mentioned, the advice in that pre-scripted message was to tell subjects to play strategically by playing 5 and really trying to explain why 3 was not going to yield them the highest payoff. So because there is this intermediary through the cell phone, the smartphone app, all the interactions and characteristics of the team leader are identical except for our treatment variations. So we have 2 treatment variations. The first is leader gender, and we do a couple of things to make that gender really salient. The first is we just inform subjects of their leader gender. Another nice feature of our design is it's implemented in Amharic, and so all of the language we're using to refer to the leader is also gendered, right? So we're using this gendered language in referring to a female or male gender. And then we additionally selected a different gendered pseudonym for each subject. So we had many different pseudonyms. They're either female names or male names, and we use that pseudonym each time the leader is mentioned, which is close to 30 times during the game. And then just to make sure that all of this worked, towards the end of our experiment on a subsample, we asked our subjects to recall their leader's gender, and 95% of them were able to do so. For leader ability, we also do a couple of things to try to signal to our subjects that their leader is of high ability. So the first thing we do is prior to playing the main game of the experiment, we had subjects play a different initial logic game. And we tell them the performance of the leader in this game, which was very good. So right from the start, they know that their leader has performed very well in this initial logic game that was quite difficult for themselves to do. We also just explicitly tell them that the leader has had training and experience playing the main signaling game. And then halfway through that signaling game, after 5 rounds, we have the enumerator add up the total points the leader has earned up to that point and compare it to the total points the subject has earned up to that point. And in expectation, the leader will have higher points because they're playing the the strategic way of playing this game. Okay, so just an overview of that timeline, especially because it's hard to know how much is being conveyed here. So subjects come in, they're right away matched to a leader and that gender is revealed. We do this initial logic game, and in blue on the bottom, you can see the different ways in which we're connoting ability for those who are randomized into the treatment arm for the high ability signal. So after that initial logic game, they're informed, those in the ability signal are informed that the leader has played very well. Then before we start this main leadership game, the ability signal subjects are told that the leader has had training and experience in playing the game, and then we start the game. So we do an initial practice run with the subjects to just make sure that they understand the game, and we do see that they behave just like university students in the United States, where most of them want to select three. We do a belief elicitation, not just on how well they're going to play, but also on how well they expect the leader will perform in the game. And then we have them play 10 rounds of this signaling game. And halfway through, for those in the ability treatment arm, we again signal to them that their leader is doing quite well. And then we end the experiment with a treatment check and confirm that they're able to accurately recall their leader's gender. Okay. So from that design, we get our estimating equation in which we're just regressing whether or not the subject followed the advice, which is whether they played strategically in this game it was selecting four or five. And we regress that on whether or not the leader was female, whether or not the subject was given that high ability signal, and then the interaction of the two. And so beta one is gonna tell us what is the gender gap in adherence just in that treatment arm for differences between men and women when no information on ability is given. Beta two is gonna give us the average return for when we provide that signal of ability for male leaders. And beta three is gonna tell us whether there is a differential added return for that ability signal for female leaders. So beta one plus beta three is also gonna be a documentation of the gender gap conditional on subjects receiving information on higher ability. So I'm just gonna say that one more time. Beta one is gonna tell us what the gender gap is without the signal. Beta one plus beta three is gonna tell us what the gender gap is with that signal of ability. And beta three is gonna tell us whether there's a differential return to ability for women. Okay, so what do we find? So these are our main results. What we see here is that despite male and female leaders being otherwise identical, when no information on ability is provided, subjects were 5 to 8 percentage points less likely to follow the advice from female leaders. And this corresponded to about a 10% difference. And it did result in female-led subjects receiving less points overall. What's surprising is that the gender gap is not only mitigated, but it's actually reversed when we provide this signal of high ability. So you can see on this table that beta three is very large and much larger than that initial downgrading of female leaders, right? And so what that tells us is that the return to that ability signal was much higher for female leaders. At the bottom of this table, we also test what the beta one plus beta three is, and not surprisingly then, the gender gap reverses. So conditional on this information of high ability, subjects were more likely to follow female leadership. We see this strongest in earlier rounds in which subjects are still learning how to play the game, right? There's a lot of uncertainty where we think advice might matter the most. And surprisingly, we don't see much effect of the ability signal for male leaders, suggesting that that signal of ability was already in line with their expectations of male performance. So as I mentioned, we did this exercise prior to playing the game on what subjects believed their leader would perform. And these ended up to be quite noisy estimates with large standard errors, but you can see that the pattern of even their beliefs on leader performance really match what we see in the experiment itself. So on average, they think that female leaders, when no ability information is provided, are going to do worse on the game. But then we see that female leaders, conditional on having that signal of ability, are expected to perform much better and even more so than men, right? So again, we see beta three is positive and larger than the negative effect we see on beta one. So this reversal in gender discrimination we find in our experiment really implies that subjects are statistically discriminating. But it's not that subjects just dislike taking direction from women, but rather they're using gender as a proxy for how competent they think their leader is. Right. What's interesting is that this reversal is also inconsistent with a very simple and standard model of statistical discrimination, in which beliefs are normally distributed, ability signals are uncorrelated with gender, and subjects update beliefs using Bayes' rule. While our design doesn't allow us to pin down exactly which of these assumptions is being violated, we do show in the paper a model in which signals are interpreted differently for each gender can explain our results. And there's actually a recent paper by Boren and co-authors that find a similar discrimination reversal, and they're able to show that this is driven by dynamic discrimination. That is, subjects account for discrimination that women face in obtaining the signal to begin with. What's interesting is we document a similar reversal, even though our experiment had no dynamic component. That is, subjects had no reason to believe that it would be more difficult for women to obtain that ability signal in our experiment. And yet they're still responding more favorably to women with the signal. What this perhaps suggests is that this phenomenon in which subjects respond particularly favorably to women with high ability might thus not be limited to dynamic setting. And this might especially be true in contexts like Ethiopia, where women generally face barriers to obtaining skills and accolades. Right? And so we might think that there's this general updating of when people see high quality women or high ability women, that they naturally infer that there must have been barriers in obtaining those signals, right? And so what's interesting in our study is that we can show that this reversal happens even though there's nothing within our study that has this dynamic component, that they're applying some sort of general rule. Okay, as I mentioned, a week after, we then go back to a subsample of our subjects and we ask them to evaluate a resume. And this is an example of the resumes we give them. You can see that on the top left corner, we just explicitly state whether the gender is male or female, as is the norm in Ethiopia. And then we also added this personal summary on the resume to again take advantage of the Amharic gendered language. And so that's how we make gender salient in the resume experiment. We asked subjects to evaluate the candidate based on competence, likability, a willingness to hire, and what salary they would offer them. Now, we do seem to be underpowered here, right? We asked them just, you know, how much they agree on a scale of 1 to 5. But what we do see is a general tendency, again, to kind of discriminate against female applicants. So on all of these measures, they viewed the female candidate as being less competent, less likable, they were less willing to hire them. And then on the salary, where we do have a lot more variation, they're about 11% less likely to offer them a lower salary by 11%. So this is again consistent that subjects are using gender to try to evaluate candidates in leadership positions or applying to leadership positions. So in conclusion, you know, we consider this paper as contributing to the literature in four main ways. First, we show that subjects respond differently to female versus male leadership, and that this differential response is driven by beliefs or is driven by statistical discrimination. And this is somewhat surprising, especially given that in many of these countries, especially in Ethiopia, there is significant gender inequality and a lot of consideration on gender norms and gender attitudes being highly unequal. And yet we're still finding that the differential response really seems to be primarily driven on beliefs, not on gender attitude. When we think about the growing literature on gender discrimination in low-income countries towards leaders, women in leadership positions, it's largely been characterized as violations of social norms. Our results instead are more consistent with Beeman and her co-authors that do find evidence of statistical discrimination in response to political leadership in India. Second, to the best of our knowledge, we're the first to identify whether gender discrimination affects adherence to leadership, which is a key input into leadership effectiveness. Right, we show that leader gender affects subjects' decision to follow leadership, even when that decision is costly to the subject. And so our results suggest that gender discrimination is a potential explanation for studies that document gender gaps in adherence to expertise. And it really adds to previous studies that have shown females in leadership positions are perceived as less effective due to gender discrimination. And so our results show that gender discrimination from subordinates may make one leader appear less effective than another, despite both having taken identical action, which really highlights a potential mechanism underlying gender gaps in leadership positions. Third, we show that information on ability has significantly higher returns for female leaders. So for example, information on ability raised our own subjects' adherence to female leaders by 12 percentage points, while it had no detectable effect for male leaders. This finding is similar to the literature we see on statistical discrimination in the labor market in the United States, where we see that the returns to education and occupational licensing are much higher for Black men and women. Right, and so our results suggest that signals of ability, such as credentials, may also be an important tool for gender equity policies in helping close the gap or increasing female representation in low-income countries. And fourth, we find that a signal of ability can reverse gender discrimination outside of a dynamic context. So this suggests a broader phenomenon in which subjects respond particularly favorably to women of high ability, perhaps due to a general environment in which women commonly face barriers in achieving accolades or obtaining skills. Importantly, such reversals also indicate that positive discrimination in favor of high ability women does not preclude the existence of discrimination against women in other contexts. So coming back to those original policy questions I posed at the start of my presentation, our results suggest that providing women with credible signals of quality may be an important policy solution to help close the gender gap that we observe in more natural settings. Our results also suggest that equalizing gender differences and inputs to women may not be sufficient to overcome gaps, at least in the short run, and that policies geared towards reducing gender discrimination should not just be limited to those who are making hiring and promotion decisions, but should really be much more widespread. So thank you so much. I look forward to questions or thoughts from the audience and the panel.
Great. So we'll take any questions from the panelists that the panelists have for Ketki. I also want to give a shout out to people in the audience. Thank you, Ted, for joining this session. We have a few co-authors we have Odysseus here, who's the who's Celine's co-author, which is going to be the next presentation. So if you all have any questions for Ketki, please type them in the chat and I will convey them. But for now, panelists, do you have any questions?
So this is just not a question, but just asking, I wonder whether in terms of members' gender, is there any difference receiving do they, like a female, are more likely to listen to female leaders, kind of? Can you look at that in some sense?
Definitely. So when we do actually try to look at that, we are a little underpowered, so it's hard to know, you know, exactly how much, but the pattern we see is consistent for both women and men. So in general, both women and men were discounting female advice when no information on ability was provided, and then both had this differential and higher response to that ability signal for women. So it doesn't seem to be the case that our results are driven just by men perhaps discriminating against women, but really is consistent across genders.
I have a question about the setup of the experiment. So right now you manipulated very cleanly gender by just changing the name and the pronoun and things like that. What would be your prediction if this was, you know, in real life where people are actually interacting, you know, in person? Of course, it would be very hard to then hold everything constant because, you know, men and women would look different. They would talk differently, have different, you know, pitches, you know, voice pitches. What do you think, what would be your prediction in having a more like in-person setting? And is that something you're considering exploring in the future?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I think once we relax kind of how strictly we held gender constant, then we would start to see just differences across gender that, or things that are correlated with gender. So there actually are studies that do suggest, I think, a larger gender gap when we do allow for that relaxation. So I'm not sure about in Ethiopia, But for example, in the United States, we did this study in the United States as well. And there we actually did change the tone of the language. And what was interesting is we didn't find gender discrimination just in terms of, you know, the female perception, but we did see that females were less likely to want to use more assertive language, right? So they were much more polite in how they wanted to provide that advice. And then because they were not as assertive, subjects were less likely to follow their direction of women, right? So I think as you, as we kind of relax what we mean by gender, you know, because a lot of things are correlated with gender, a lot of these concerns of, you know, are women less confident? Do they have less training in how kind of assertive they are? Or do they just have preferences where they have reduced assertion could actually increase that gender gap even further?
And do you expect your treatment to also be effective in that case? Or do you, would that be your prediction that, you know, the gap is larger, but then it could potentially be reduced or even reversed in the case of in-person interactions?
I think it might be. I mean, to the extent that we think that this is driven by beliefs, you know, it might make the return a little less or something if there's this countervailing effect from reduced confidence or reduced use of language choice or something like that. But to the extent that these results are suggesting that they are updating beliefs about women's ability, we should still expect that women in these higher positions or having higher credentials will still get that greater gain. So I think the policy direction of providing credentials would still hold.